There are a couple of moments that I remember with special clarity. Two bells that awakened me to the possibility that Vassar had a remarkable collection of architectural books. The first rang a couple of years ago on a visit I paid to Special Collections. Ron Paskus had always been very helpful to me and my students, pulling out unusual texts, explaining them, helping those that had special interests, and I thought I knew more or less what was in the collection. But Ron called me over to say that he'd found in the uncatalogued section of Special Collections a book by the great 18th century engraver and etcher Giovanni Battista Piranesi. Would I like to see it? Of course I would. Subsequently, I taught a seminar entitled The Rome of the Imagination, based around the prints that Ron had discovered. Here's one of the title pages for the Antiquities of Rome. And here, one of the great images that Piranesi provides, an illustration of the Severan marble map of the city. More things popped up, other volumes of Piranesi prints, and then other treats, uncatalogued or hiding in the old Dewey classification system, and invisible from the online catalog. The second bell rang when, together with our art librarian, Tom Hill, I started to cruise the art library shelves. This was dirty and somewhat boring work. Tom had an amusing way of wearing a World War I helmet to protect his head against the extruded light fixtures. But we simply walked up and down the shelves, pulling out books that seemed especially old. Here's an early discovery, just a tip of what turned out to be an iceberg. The book is called Contrasts, and it's by the English architect Augustus Welby Northmore Pugin, published in 1836. This is the first edition, and it's probably the best-known book of the Gothic Revival. Pugin juxtaposed the imagery of the modern day, seen above, with the images of the churches of the medieval period. These, as you can see, he represents with lush, atmospheric imagery. The architects of the day, Pugin intones, are weighed in the balance and found wanting for high architectural crimes, picturesque superficiality, and stylistic indifference. And here you can see the architecture of the current day and the architecture of the Middle Ages weighed in the balance and found wanting. What was especially exciting about our copy was that there was a signature on the flyleaf. It had been owned by Robert C. Long, an architect in Baltimore. Long had introduced the Gothic Revival to that city, and he dated his ownership of the book to 1839. So here we have a very specific example of a book, a major work of Gothic Revival architecture, that is the source for the Gothic Revival in the city of Baltimore. Well, Pugin and Piranesi, from here it took off. Further study in Special Collections revealed other treasures, so that between the art library and Special Collections, Vassar, we began to understand, had remarkable strengths in architecture. The origins of this collection, how it came to be at Vassar, can be read about in the catalog. And in this short program, I thought I'd show you a couple of works in slightly greater detail. Let me start with a pair that have interesting ownership records. Vassar is very lucky to have a number of versions of Andrea Palladio's four books on architecture, not, sadly, an early Italian edition, but still some fine 18th century English translations. We also have one of the lesser-known books by Palladio in a later edition. This is actually not by Palladio, it's an updated version of the guidebook that he wrote for the city of Rome. He published his version in 1554, and this one is dated to 1588. The updating is clear from the woodcut at the top of the page. There are obelisks in the image at the top, labeled 605P, and the arms of the Parenti family that dates the work to after the erection of the obelisks by Pope Sixtus at the end of the 16th century. On the title page, you can see that someone's made some underlinings in brown ink to pick out special parts. La guida romana che insegna facilmente ai forestieri a ritrovare le più notabili cose di Roma. A Roman guidebook, which teaches simply or easily to foreigners how to find the most notable things in Rome. We also have an ownership signature on the inside. Hic liber est Tomai Ciflecti. Prioris Belli Fontanis, it reads. This book belongs to Thomas Chifflet, prior of Bellefontaine. Bellefontaine is a Benedictine abbey between Nantes and Angers in western France. And Thomas Chifflet can probably be identified with a prior who came to Rome with Queen Christina of Sweden in the middle of the 16th century. All this suggests that the guidebook had a long and useful life. Our copy of the mid-16th century architectural treatise of Sebastiano Serlio is equally interesting, perhaps a little more puzzling. Serlio was one of the first to bring together in book form the major works of ancient Roman architecture and those of the modern day that demonstrated that the moderns could not only rival but even exceed the skills of the ancients. So he illustrates with simple line woodcuts the ancient works. Here is the Pantheon. As well as the modern. Here is Bramante's Tempietto. Bramante was his special hero. Bramante was the first architect to have rivaled, properly speaking, the ancients. Our copy is a generous gift from a former Vassar president, Henry Noble McCracken, as the book plate reveals. But our book also has an interesting history. Inside, there are some geometric sketches and a caricature drawing as well. And at the back, there's a record of an 18th century sale in the area of Lugano. It reads that Carlo Antonio Brignone from Breno has brought this book from Martin Brignone of Breno. He's paid 10 lire in the money of Lugano. And then it goes on, ho fatto religare, I had it rebound in Brescia. And that cost me 22.5 lire, and the date is 1583. Well, we haven't been able to trace down who the Brignoni are. Breno is a small town on the borders of Switzerland, as you would expect. It would be interesting to know whether these notes correspond to whether the book was rebound because the owners wanted to use the book for advice about architecture, or whether they appreciated its antiquarian value. I'm going to conclude with two works, one from the 17th and the other from the 18th century. The history of St. Paul's in London has been acclaimed by historians of architecture as one of the first monographs devoted to a single building. Actually, the book tells a slightly different tale. It was assembled by the antiquarian William Dugdale, who you see on the right, and illustrated by the etcher and graver Wenceslaus Hollar. It is, in fact, a celebration of the long history of Christianity in England as embodied in its churches and cathedrals. Hollar's engravings are of special interest. Here is his record of the memorial to John Donne. Hollar came from Bohemia, and worked for Thomas Howard, the Earl of Arundel, and then for the Duke of York. For the most part, however, he was a topographical artist, untrained in architecture. Thus, his etchings for the history of St. Paul's are drawn in perspective, something that makes the building seem rather precarious. There are no sections, no elevations, none of the kinds of drawing that architects prized and would use to have a full and correct record of the building. Only the ground plan has been carefully scaled in feet and has the accuracy that someone interested in the architecture would actually need. Of special interest are the exterior elevations. In 1666, the Great Fire of London destroyed St. Paul's, and Hollar's engravings are the best record of the church as it existed on the eve of the Civil War. They're also important as a record of the additions made by Inigo Jones, the mid-17th century architect in the middle years of that century. Starting in 1634, Jones rebuilt the entrance porch, placing there a giant Corinthian facade based on Roman models. Dugdale seems to register no shock or no sense of surprise at the contrast between the original Gothic building, which you can see in the center of the image, and the clothing of classical additions that Jones has placed around it. He only praises Charles for the generosity of his contributions. The image is interesting here because it shows not just the Corinthian porch at the front, portico at the front of the church, but you can also see that Jones has tried to give the building the squared stone surface of an ancient building. Another book that really requires to be held in hand and turn the pages is Henry Repton's Sketches and Hints on Landscape Gardening. Repton was one of the most important figures in landscape design during the late 18th and early 19th century, and he promoted his idea of the proper style of landscape gardening and brought that art to a new level of prominence. His book designs were also original. Repton would present clients with a series of before and after watercolors that featured flaps overlaying images of the patron's property, making the existing landscape and proposed changes particularly easy to compare. Because of their red leather bindings, these volumes come to be known as the Red Books, and he translated this bespoke presentation method to modern techniques of book production. Here, for example, is a before and after image of one country estate. Above, the flaps are in place. You can hardly see the join. And then withdrawn below, you see how he has imagined the redesign not only of the house, but also of all the landscaping around it to create a wonderful deep vista. Naturally, the additions of cows that lend a certain picturesque pleasure to the site. A road across running from right to left also leads up into the hills beyond. Or here, where the fence has been removed, the pond opened out to make a stream, the cows left to roam, and new plantings set up around the front of the pond. Here, as you can readily see, as before, the fence preventing the young children from seeing the vista, and here is what replaces it. We've called this exhibition the Architect's Library as a way of describing our focus. But architecture is by its nature multidisciplinary. What questions would you ask? If you are interested in representational techniques, our books range from the orthogonal elevations of Serlio and Palladio in the 16th century to the complex axonometric representations of John Hayduck in the 20th. These books tell of changes in the technology of image reproduction, with the development of woodcuts, engravings, aquatints, and photographic collage. Historians of science will find connections to 17th century science in the works of Abraham Bosse and Gérard Desargues and Bernard Belidor. Students of history can examine the evolution of royal and aristocratic dwellings, they like, but attitudes toward the poor as well. Here's an image of Ackroyden, one of the philanthropic settlements advanced by the mid-19th century reformer James Hole, and so on. In the end, nothing so effectively represents society's values and daily life as architecture, and books have been there to record it. Architects make concrete our routines and rituals, fixing time and holding it fast. But nothing more effectively melts these concrete confections or liberates the imagination than the book. The images that puncture the picture plane, offering us a lifeline out of the here and now. This catalog and exhibition encourage you to experience these notable books for yourselves and for your own purposes.